Hi everyone, and welcome back to Lesson 5, Level 1. In this video, we'll be covering the first of our lookup functions, the Vlookup function. At the beginning of Chapter 5, we are given the scenario where we are heading up the equipment division of the zone. What we typically have to do for our customers is to determine the product costs, and to do this, we get to look through a big, huge price book and determine the cost of each order. So instead of us looking up all the prices in this big catalog, life's too short for that, so we want to automate this process. In this scenario, we're dealing with tennis balls. They don't deal with individual tennis balls, but rather tubes containing three balls per tube, like you've probably seen in the sporting goods store. Each tube we're going to call a unit. So when we take an order for a customer, we enter the quantity of units here in this column. Based upon this quantity, that determines the customer's price for tennis balls. The more they order on a given order, the better the price they receive. We also have to take into account the shipping costs of how much it will cost to ship this order, depending on whether they want to use truck, ship, or rail. We want to customize this sheet so it will automatically calculate all of this for us. We covered one way to calculate this price in Lesson 4. We learned that we could create a big long nested if function that calculates this price. Let's say we wanted to do this for this first customer. We have an order here for 240 units, and we can see here that the unit price for 240 or above cans of tennis balls is $2. So how can we automatically calculate this unit price? From what we know thus far, we can create a pretty complicated if statement where we have two nested or embedded if functions inside this first if function. Let me quickly look at this big formula that I spent several minutes in creating to see what it does. It starts off here looking at the quantity in D14 to see if that cell is greater than or equal to A10, and if it is, then we render B10 or the $2. If it's not, then we go to the next if statement here to see if the quantity is greater than or equal to A9 or for a value of 120. If it is, then we render the price in B9 or $2.12. If that check is also false, then we do another if function to see if the quantity is greater than A8 or 60. If that check is true, then we render A8 or $2.27. If that check's false, then all three of these if statements are false, and the only remaining choice is to render the last lonely B7 out here for $2.45. Phew! Life's too short for me to write all those nested if statements. And this one only had four prices. Can you imagine dozens of different pricing levels and how long that would take? No way. Lesson 5 introduces us to a variety of lookup functions. Lookup functions are much easier to do and much more powerful. The first lookup function that I'm going to introduce you to is the VLOOKUP or vertical lookup function. Let me clear out all this hard work here, and instead of this, we'll put our VLOOKUP function here. Equals VLOOKUP. And as you can see, the function looks for a value in the leftmost column of a table and then returns a value in the same row from a column you specify. By default, the table must be sorted in ascending order. What do we mean by table? Basically, a table is just a number of cells in a rectangle of a certain width and a certain height, or columns and rows. For example, this is a table of 2 columns wide by 4 rows high, or 5 if you include the title row, which we normally don't do, by the way. Going back to our VLOOKUP, the first parameter that the function is requesting is the lookup value, or what value do we want to look up in our lookup table. What we want to base our pricing off of is the quantity of units on the order, so the lookup value is going to be the quantity here in the same row, D14, comma, and the next step is the table array. This is our table where we're going to look up the quantity in order to determine our price. So I'm just going to highlight the table. These 8 cells, not including the header row, never include the header row. Now we need the column index number, or which column number do we want to bring back from the table? We're looking up 240 in this first column, right? We want to bring back or render the pricing column here in the second column of the table, so we want a 2 here in this formula. Now another comma, and we have the optional range lookup. We need to give it either a true or a false value here. True says we're going to look up an approximate match and that the first column of the table must be in ascending order. Looks like I either did it right before, or I just got lucky, as these quantity breaks are already in ascending order. If they aren't, you'll get all wrong values back, so don't do that. False says we'll only find exact matches. If we choose false, the order of the first column in our lookup table doesn't matter, as it will just hunt through the first column and see if there's an exact match here. So if in this first order we try to look up 240 and we find that exact number in our lookup table, then we'll bring back the corresponding price for 240. So we got lucky with that number that we wanted to look up, as it just happened to be one of the quantity breaks. For this next row, we'd go to our lookup table, try to find 30, and if it doesn't exist in this column here, we just throw an NA error. If we give it a true, then it'll look for an approximate match. In our 30 row, Excel will look in our lookup table and start at the top of it and see that 30 is greater than 0. So we then go to the next one down, and it checks to see if that 30 is greater than this one, and it isn't. So we go back with the 0 value of $2.45. If we have a 240 or greater, then Excel will ultimately slide down all these values and just return the highest value of $2. Based upon this choice in logic, we want to pick true and close our parentheses. Before I copy the formula down, I'd better lock these cell references for this table with absolute references so that it will work for all these rows. Now if I drag this formula down, let's see what we come up with. 240 has a price of $2, so that checks. 30 is 245, yeah. Quantities of 160 and 215 are both in this range, so they're both 212. 90 is in here, so that's 227. And 15 is in this range, so it's 245. Just to show you what happens if we change this match parameter to false in our second row, we see that the lookup couldn't find an exact match, so it threw an error just like we expected. Let me change it back, and it all looks good, so that's it for the unit price. There are a couple of important things to note about this VLOOKUP function. It's both useful and powerful, but you have to follow a few rules. The lookup values must be in the first column of your lookup table, and they must also be in ascending order. If you don't have these two bases covered, you'll get a lot of incorrect results. So let's move on to the total price. This column will just be the quantity times our newly found unit price. All right, copy that down, and that one's done now too. Now what about our unit shipping column? Our requested unit shipping over here has these values in it, and we see here that these values need to be looked up in this lookup table up here. The lookup table contains the shipping cost per unit for each of these four shipping methods. This VLOOKUP function is going to look similar to the previous constructed unit price function. Equals VLOOKUP, left parentheses. The value that we're going to look up is going to be this cell here. The table that we're going to look up our values in is this range of cells here. Again, make sure you exclude the title row. The column that we want to retrieve the price from is the second column, so again we put in a 2 here. This time we are not going to use a true or approximate match because we don't want Excel to guess what our cost should be if it can't make an exact match from our lookup value. So we're going to use false and force an exact match. Let's close our parentheses and hit enter. Now I need to fix those references in our formula here like I did before, but rather than just putting the dollar signs in here to force our absolute referencing, I'm going to go to the trouble of naming this range of cells holding our lookup table so that we can see that name in our formula as opposed to all those ugly cell references. I'll highlight those cells and name this range as shipping costs. Now I'll go back to my formula and replace that range of cells with my newer, easier to read cell range of shipping costs and hit enter. Now if we have rail here, we go to the corresponding cost of 20 cents per unit. Let me drag that down and, oh crap, what do we have here? Now, like I demonstrated previously, if we don't have an exact match between our lookup value and our lookup table, then we throw this NA error. Let's try to figure out why. Looking at this cell and comparing it to the first column in our table, I see the issue. This cell has train as its value in it, and this table doesn't have the value of train in it. This is probably due to a data entry error in our order sheet. So we can either add the value of train to this lookup table and give it the same price as rail, but I think that I'd rather just change this data value from train to rail so that it's consistent with the other values up here. So now you know how VLOOKUP works. See you in the next video.